Hello.
Hello, Jamie. How you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you doing, Ben?
It's great to speak to you again. The last time we talked was 2012, I think.
It may have been. It was definitely a long time ago.
Yeah, and a lot has happened in that time. The world has changed. We've progressed in our lives. And so, how you doing?
I'm doing personally overall great, in terms of everything I've been doing with things we talked about in the past, memes or liberty culture and comics and stuff, and personally otherwise, yeah, just fantastic. How about you?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm in a, my life is different than it was when we last spoke. You've seen me go through the whole handstand and yoga phase, and now I'm into sort of more of like a business-minded phase. And in that time, Trump happened as well. In that time, so like everything changed anyway. Are you still doing the voluntarist comic?
Oh yeah, definitely. And actually the last comic we did was the most successful yet, in terms of funding and number of backers, number of pages.
So what's the situation with that? Like, how many episodes have you done? And how, like, tell us about the funding. Like, give us an overview.
Sure. So, when it comes to the comic now, I mean, it's kind of wild 'cause you've been there since the beginning, which is pretty cool. Not too many people could say that, they were there from the beginning, but you were. There's been several issues that have come out since that time. And actually, I think I've run now about eight campaigns, but there's now been a change in how I do things, starting with the origin story. So about what is now, the last issue, I went and started to actually go from the beginning of the story with voluntarist and start to, tell the story chronologically. Because before I was kind of doing a prototype of the universe, showing people what it would be like, just to get some interest and, generate some fandom. But now it hit that critical point where I'm like, okay, I have enough people understanding the concepts and I, have the artwork out there. And I have, kind of the story laid out nicely. So I felt comfortable moving forward and actually going on the origin story, and starting at the beginning. And so, I did a campaign for the first issue, which was pretty successful. And then the second issue was the most successful campaign of all time. We had 124% of the goal. And now I'm actually working on the third issue, going the chronology here. So I'm pretty excited about it.
So, for people that are listening, if they want to look it up while we're talking, it's the Voluntarist comic, the comic series, right, on Facebook.
Exactly. Yeah, Voluntarist, the comic series at volcomic.com. So that's VOLCOMIC, volcomic.com. And that's where the main website is for, all the content and updates and things like that. But obviously, we're on Facebook, we're on YouTube, and so forth. And you can catch the links there on the page.
Yeah. How many people are involved? Like, what part do you play? Do you write the storyline? Who does the illustrations? How does it work?
All right, so I'm the executive producer, line producer, and writer. So I've come up with the ideas. I created all the foundational concepts and writing the story, doing the promotions, website, and all other good stuff. But I myself, I'm not talented and practiced in comic drawing. I mean, I do some graphic design, and I have some digital talents and photography. I know Photoshop and other things like that. But doing that kind of line work, really takes someone who is a professional who's dedicated themselves to that. So, over the years, I've worked with many artists, actually. Often, it can take teams of people. And at this point, I've worked with dozens of them. I mean, I've actually, worked with several different art groups. I've had artists who do various things for me, because I'm not just making a comic here. Sometimes, I'm doing other types of artwork for stickers or shirts. I've done action figures. I've done now this comic card, like a deck building card game prototype and stuff. So, there's a lot involved. And at this point, definitely, 50 plus artists have probably worked on something for the voluntarist at this point. In addition to myself, having done things with it. So, and this coming issue, actually, I'm working with a new art team because the other art team I was working with, I'd been happy with them for a while, but they kind of didn't come through when they were supposed to. And I still have another thing I'm working with, but I'm kind of just giving it a pause with them and working with another art team in the meantime for this next issue.
And I'm wondering, like, have you developed like, have you taken your comic to events and stuff? Have you developed relationships and friendships and, you know, community around the comic?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, it's blossomed beyond what I thought it would in terms of, you know, how just niche it is technically. I mean, it is a niche comic in that the content in, you know, in fandom appeals to people who already identify, you know, as libertarians or voluntarists, and so forth. So, you know, I already knew coming in this might be a tougher thing to get out there. But the thing is everything that's transpired since, you know, even since we last talked, in the comic and entertainment world, thanks to all the SJWs, you know, ruining comics by trying to rewrite characters and stories and do all the other kind of stuff, has pushed a lot of people actually, I think, outside of, you know, the niche realm to come and enjoy the comic, because I'm offering something different. I'm offering a new tale that has a whole different world, like a background for ethics and how things work in the world, with a unique and compelling story. When a lot of mainstream publishers, you know, whether it's, you know, film producers or comic writers, they're just coming up empty. They're not telling engaging stories that really probe philosophy or ethics or, you know, make you think at all. And I think a lot of people are starving for that. You know, a lot of people are upset. That was the direction that comic publishers are taking. And, you know, my comic book isn't necessarily like, you know, in that realm of, oh, being anti-SJW, like some people have, you know, done and been more successful in with comics and other things. But just the fact that I'm not interested in identity politics, I'm interested in, you know, a great story that's compelling and interesting that makes the reader, you know, really think about the nature of what it means to be free. I mean, I think that has itself its own independent draw. And so I definitely have seen a lot of people come in and enjoy and be intrigued just because I'm not, you know, relying on lazy writing or just trying to appeal to identity politics. You know, I'm interested in the story first and, you know, making a compelling narrative first.
Yeah. Nice job. That's really cool. Let's segue a little bit. There might be people listening that don't really know anything about the philosophy. Could you describe what's the difference between libertarianism and voluntarism?
Sure. So voluntarism is probably the most unfamiliar to people. It's just this idea that individuals should try to maximize consent with each other and minimize the initiation of violence. And that, you know, that is the initiation of force against others. And so voluntarism is a philosophy that is really focused on helping people be less violent in their physical actions towards others, and also be more effective in their communication with others. And what that does is it's about respecting people's individual bodies and their properties, and not, you know, giving excuses or rationalizations for hurting people if it's done, you know, with a special shiny badge or if it's done by government. And just for some simple corollaries, you know, when we often voluntarists strike chords with people, it's about the nature of the state versus the individual. And in many ways, the state, that is those working in the government, do things to individuals that would not be acceptable for an individual to do to another, right? Like conscription would be considered kidnapping, or war, you know, initiating war would be considered murder in any other context. You know, taking someone and throwing them in a cage because they have a plant would be considered, you know, obviously a form of kidnapping, battery, and theft. But the government does these things to people where people are not physically hurting others or physically stealing things from others. And so that's a really important philosophical development of trying to move the evolution of humanity psychology forward. And libertarianism is, you know, within that blanket that is a small L. I mean, some people think about the Libertarian Party and politics, but libertarianism as an ideology falls, you know, along those lines of trying to maximize consent and minimize the initiation of violence among people. And then there's different forms of libertarianism, but, you know, voluntarism can fit, you know, within that as well.
Yeah. Sometimes personally, I find it easier just to describe myself as a libertarian in terms of, like, people are more likely to kind of grasp what I mean by that than, you know,
right,
having to explain the full explanation. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Sometimes people identify. And then, of course, then there's people who have misconceptions too, and then you have to, you know, disabuse them of those misconceptions because, like, oh, you're a libertarian, you must hate poor people and hate roads, you know, and things like that, which is silly, obviously silly lies from people in the media most often. But But yeah, it's a lot of fun.
I see your partner has a Facebook page called The Philosopher, right?
Yes, yes. So The Philosopher was a big project that, you know, transpired in between when we last talked. That's been a lot of fun to work on producing and promoting. And, you know, she's absolutely great and, you know, loves talking about important things like peaceful parenting, you know, nonviolent communication, thinking, you know, through things to, you know, kind of push people's ethical philosophy. So that's been a long-going project now that has, you know, seen some success now.
Yeah, and it's great to see you've found someone who's aligned with the same values as yours. So how did you meet each other?
Yeah, that's a funny story. The way we met, this is going to sound pretty wild, was that she slid up in my DMs. so she messaged me, and the reason why she messaged me is because Adam Kokesh was doing a tour several years ago, his Freedom Tour, and I tabled actually at one of his events. And at the time, he was dating this girl named Macy. That, you know, didn't work out, unfortunately. But even though it didn't work out, because they traveled across, you know, the U.S. and, you know, met in different groups and people and took pictures with them, I happened to like a picture that she was in. And because I liked that picture that she was in, she looked to see who liked it. And then checked out my profile, you know, and saw, oh, you know, this guy likes Liberty and comics, and she was really into that. And it, you know, sparked off a conversation, and then we kept talking and talking, and then one thing led to another, and eventually we got together. So it was pretty great.
It's funny. I was just thinking to myself, in the UK, we don't have libertarians. I mean, there isn't really the same thing. There isn't that movement, you know? It's peculiar. I think the closest thing is really like environmentalists, mm-hmm. and they're, you know, they're pretty sort of left wing, liberal, hard left kind of thing. I don't think we have an equivalent, really. I mean, I'm struggling to think of what the equivalent is.
Right. I mean, it's a part of the history of the UK. You know, the whole concept of their government was never even founded in an idea of individual liberty. You know, it was an outgrowth of the nobles who wanted to also have power, you know, pushing to, you know, create a parliament. So that way those who already had, you know, feudal power could continue to maintain that power and have more of a say with other rulers. So, you know, America has at least in semblance of spirit, not unfortunately, not all the way through, but in semblance of spirit, this idea of individualism and resisting taxation, resisting, you know, not being represented and those kinds of things. But the UK doesn't have that history, and instead, unfortunately, has had a history of individual oppression that's grown throughout the years. And of course, I'm sure as you see now, I mean, the level of spying and bans on everything, especially in London, is just outrageous.
Yeah. It's interesting when I think how my own outlook on things has changed radically. Like if I go back, you know, perhaps when we first got to know each other or 10 years ago, I mean, I used to I understand why people cherish those principles of freedom in the West as Americans do, you know, or at least libertarian constitutionalists do. I understand it now. I understand that. And I used to think of people's allegiance to the flag or people's identifying with the national identity as just kind of mindless, brainless sort of herd mentality belonging to a team. I used to think of it as just like a, you know, it was just the dumb mouth breathers who wanted to associate with a team, you know, for no reason. But then as time's gone on, I understand what the values that it represents, you know, and stuff. And so I get that now. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, I understand what you're saying. I mean, obviously, I'm a staunch individualist, and in a lot of regards, I, you know, reject nationalism as a concept. But I understand where you're coming from in this idea that there are certainly admirable elements of people's histories where they admire that people took a stand for individual liberty and for trying to secure that against people who would try to, you know, use whatever means to steal and plunder and murder. So I definitely appreciate that concept of being thankful for those who came before you and their efforts to try to secure liberty against, you know, those who would try to take it away. So I completely understand that concept, of course. Unfortunately, you know, as you may have also seen, when the government, you know, is pushing the narrative, nationalism is often used as a means to manipulate for more state sanctioned violence, unfortunately. Very rarely, you know, or at least if it does come about, it's very brief. Does that type of sentiment lead to people standing up and resisting true tyranny, and, you know, trying to secure individual rights against, you know, those who would try to attack people? So I get what you're saying from that perspective.
Yeah, sure. I want to get to the issue of Trump shortly, but there's just a couple of things I was going to ask you first. Did you study law? Am I right?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I do have a law degree.
And I see the Honest Teacher page. Is that you?
That's a top secret thing that you know, I can't say, but maybe.
Right, okay, maybe. Okay.
But yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Right. So people can check that out if they want. And then I'm wondering, so what's it like being a teacher, and how do you find that, you know, being a free market voluntarist? What's that like for you?
Right. So teaching was a thing I did in the past. So I you know, I did some time teaching. I was a substitute teacher. I was a full-time substitute teacher, and I was also a full-time regular classroom teacher. And I taught students mostly between 6th and 12th grade, depending on the venue. And, you know, I taught classes like Geometry Honors, Senior English, University of Cambridge, ACE program, which is like a special type of honors, like, you know, IB or AP, but it's, you know, University of Cambridge. And, you know, that experience for me really helped to contextualize a lot of what is going on and manipulating and dumbing people down in America and, of course, other places where there's compulsory schooling. And, you know, I'm not completely unfamiliar with a lot of schooling process because obviously I was once in school myself. My dad also taught for 30 years at a inner city school. He taught at inner city middle school for 30 years, and I got to go and visit that, and it was pretty scary how bad it was. They had metal detectors, they had drug dogs, they had, you know, police officers, and this stuff was put in, you know, in the 80s. You know, we're not talking about a response to, you know, shootings or something like that. We're talking about how bad it was. You know, they were doing that starting in the 80s. So it was a rough school. But I got to see as a teacher, as a student, you know, former student, and through my father's teaching, kind of the total picture of what schooling does to the human psychology, and how children are just by the nature of the system itself abused in the process. And you know, I really got to dissect it by being there firsthand, working with other teachers, working with counselors, psychologists, psychiatrists, ESC, you know, special education coordinators, working with families. And of course, I also did private tutoring, things like that as well. So I got to be in families' homes and other things. But I just got to see a full gamut of what schooling fundamentally does to kids. And what it does is it essentially destroys their natural learning initiative, destroys their critical thinking ability, and puts them into an all or nothing mindset that the only way they're going to have any meaning in life is with good grades, right? Good grades are basically your value as a human being. You know, whether they try to downplay that or not, it's just the truth. The system is built around that fact. So, you know, I've been working to help undo a lot of those lies and manipulations. And part of that is promoting the Alliance for Self-Directed Education, which is a not-for-profit that helps people of, you know, all different backgrounds, all different, you know, personalities, helps them realize that schooling does not necessarily mean education. And you can have learning and meaningful learning, rewarding learning, long-term learning, without having to have your day broken up into 50-minute classes, you know, for 12 years of your life. So, you know, that's been a big, you know, mission of mine is to promote self-directed education, especially these past few years.
And what is that? Is that the same as homeschooling or what?
No, that's a great question. So a lot of people think, oh, you know, you just, is that just homeschooling instead or something like that? But no, actually, self-directed education comes in many forms. The self-directed education in the homeschooling context it's typically called unschooling. So it's this idea that if you're going to be at home, then your parents are there to be your helpers, not your judge. So parents facilitate and help a child with questions they have, or if they want to learn more about something, trying to give them access to that. So if they're interested in animals, you know, maybe taking them to the zoo or taking them to pet stores to learn about things firsthand. If they're interested in computers, you know, getting a computer or, you know, giving them access to computers to learn different things. It's just helping to foster an individual child's passions and curiosities. And on an organizational level, this looks like what's called a self-directed learning center. And some popular names of these would be like a Sudbury Valley School or Sudbury School or Agile Learning Centers. And what those look like is buildings where children ages around like 5 or 6 up through about 17 all are in the same environment, in the same facility. And these facilities are robust, where they have lots of different rooms. They have a kitchen, living room, you know, play areas, music rooms, outdoor space so kids can, you know, use a basketball court. There's, you know, water for fishing. There's, you know, plenty of freedom so that children of all ages can interact and tackle their passions. And what, you know, this has been done, you know, this isn't something recent. This has been done at one specific location, the Sudbury Valley School in Massachusetts, I believe, for some 60 plus years. And the results are that young people, through their own initiative, learn, you know, reading, writing, arithmetic, other basic life skills, just by the nature of playing with others and having fun and play, you know, doing things and having games and whatever. They do it on their own. And then if and when they're ready, because, you know, they have to get to that maturation level where they're ready to choose, they all, without fail, go on to either study for a collegiate path if that's what they want to do, or they go to trade school, or they do an independent entrepreneurial thing. It's no different than any type of high school you could imagine. It's just the difference is that instead of being threatened or shamed or pressured or hurried, these kids have this beautiful flexibility to learn what they're curious about on their own terms and set their own goals. And what that means is that these kids are happier. They're more well-rounded in terms of their knowledge and interests because they're interacting with a diversity of people instead of just, you know, the same person who came out of their mother's womb at the same around about time, and they have a rich, diversity of interests and self-directed missions that are able to be fostered because they have the free time to pursue those things. If they want to do an apprenticeship, if they want to travel, or, you know, they want to get, you know, some type of shadowing in it, maybe an aquarium or something, they actually have the freedom and time to do this. So it's pretty incredible.
And does the government approve of this? Like, can kids choose to, parents rather, choose to put their kids into a school like this as opposed to like a regular school?
Yeah, I mean, and in many states, it's considered just like a private school, and they're able to, you know, basically just file that paperwork, and that's it. And otherwise, they're, you know, kids are free to go. And that's true of most states. I believe that most states have some mechanism by which a Sudbury-styled school could exist without any problems.
Right, I see. And so in the UK, we have Montessori and Steiner. Is that a similar concept?
Right. So those kinds of schools are definitely a step in that direction. They definitely focus on giving children more autonomy, more left-right brain thinking with creative things, integration of arts and things like that. But they're not quite yet self-directed because there's still a curriculum, especially Montessori. There's still, you know, mandatory aspects to it. But obviously there's a lot less pressure with not the homework stuff and not, having to do lots of, you know, worksheets just to satisfy the teachers and things like that. So, you know, it's definitely a step in the right direction. Absolutely. But it's not quite the most ethical, in my opinion, you know, education, which is self-directed, which is, you know, even self-directed learning in principle means that a child could take classes. It's not like, oh, a child cannot be in a, you know, a classroom. They can. It's just, it should be about their choice, right? Like if you were a young person, you're like, okay, well, you know, I've always wanted to take, you know, handstand lessons. You could take classes for that if you wish to. If you wanted to learn about computer programming, you could take classes, or you wanted to take a class on Japanese cinema, whatever. It doesn't matter. You can do that if you wish. But the first key to self-directed education is that a child has a meaningful choice about that, you know, and you don't have that in compulsory public school.
Yeah, got it. How many of these places are there? Like, if parents are listening to this and thinking, God, sign me up.
There's hundreds. If you go to self-directed.org or just Google, you know, Alliance for Self-Directed Education, they have a whole list of places all across the world. And people are growing it. Even in places like China, people are trying to create these new facilities. So not only is it, you know, something that is available, but it is growing. Obviously, it's not to the levels that I'd like to see in, you know, in terms of ethical outcomes. But I think that the public school systems at large have gotten so atrocious. I mean, just absolutely insane in terms of their demands of students, the amount of hours they're spending, the constant prepping for tests and standardized exams and, you know, final exams that they're loading on to do for the districts and the states and the federal government. I mean, it's just crazy. And you know, even parents are now recognizing that going to these public schools is just dysfunctional because they overload the kids and they're constantly hurried to take tests. And there's lots of bullying going on, and there's not a lot of freedom for, you know, young people to explore their own passions. And parents are just getting tired of it, and they're exiting.
Yeah, right. And how is it funded? Is it expensive?
So it depends on which kind of center. There's some that operate on more like a community co-op level, where there's not a lot of expense to it. If you know what I mean, how they organize that, almost like a share space or a co-op, and then it goes all the way up to where there's really nice, super, you know, facilities where students are paying something comparative to like going to a nice private school. You know, depends on which one. Could be 8,000 to 12,000 or more potentially. So there are many different types of facilities and different prices. But obviously, the more people do this, the more that people join in, the cheaper it's going to be, the more that there's going to be able to be scholarships for those, you know, in financial need, just like there are at private schools already. I actually was a private school scholarship recipient myself for financial need growing up. So, it's a matter of adoption. You know, just like anything else, you know, technology starts where only the rich have it. You know, those who can afford it have it, just like cell phones. You know, used to be only, you know, super rich people had big, hunky, you know, chonking cell phones. And now even homeless Joe has a smartphone, right? So the more things get adopted in the market, the more users, the more competition, the lower the price, the higher the quality happens over time. And that's exactly what's happening with self-directed education.
Right. So there is quite a lot of freedom and possibility there. It's not like, you know, you take your kids to some kind of alternative form of school and, you know, you're going to get arrested. It's not quite that savage. Is that right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, I mean, and actually that's a big part of why many parents leave to these schools is that in many cases, there's a parent who has a child and maybe they have a little learning disability or maybe they were labeled ADHD or they're something on the autism spectrum. And they're upset at how their child's been treated in schools, even though, you know, schools are supposed to have accommodations and, you know, special coordinators that can help kids. I mean, even then, it's just, and for what I've seen, it's just an absolute insanity to think that you can meaningfully accommodate such diverse learners in a school environment. And, you know, really, it just ends up making these kids feel super frustrated because the schooling timetable and process doesn't fit what someone with those, you know, special needs has. And so, you know, a self-directed environment for many of these kids is a relief and they flourish. You know, the second that you get these kids out that where they were having lots of stress in school because they weren't able to conform to the expectations, now they're flourishing and they're able to read and really enjoy life and grow their skills because they have the freedom to do so. And they're not being told, oh, you have to stop playing. Oh, you have to stop reading. Put that book down. And suddenly these kids who once, you know, were scorned in school by teachers and administrators are now, you know, flourishing. So I think that's an important thing to also realize is that for many young kids, self-directed learning centers aren't simply, you know, a place to have more freedom, but it's a place where they can actually flourish because schooling was hampering their development.
Yeah, I see. Okay, let's shift gears, as Alex Jones would say. Did you vote in the last election?
For which one? You're saying 2016 or whatever?
Yeah.
No, I didn't care.
Okay.
I think I may, if anything, I may have cast a I think I did this before too, the protest vote, just writing in Ron Paul or something like that,
right?
You know what I mean? Like, it just, you know, obviously statistically, you know, at that level your vote, I mean, my gosh, it's The amount of corruption is absolutely insane. Politically, I'm not a big political solutions person at all. I mean, obviously there is validity to trying to reach out to people using that, because sometimes, again, people only listen when it's election time, and that's the time that you can catch their ear. It was obviously all an interesting battle of cronyism.
So, yeah, right. So what's your feelings, what's your views on Trump and the current state of society?
I mean, so from what I've seen, what I understand is, Trump, he's not like, he's not an outsider in a political sense. Technically, he's been friendly and friends with many of these people that you see, you know, are his critics or opponents for a number of years. You know, they come to his wedding, they come to his country club and all that good stuff. So this idea that Trump is intellectually outside, an intellectual outsider, I think is a little bit far-fetched. From what I've seen personally, Trump has just had a personal axe to grind with people who don't like him, which of course is, as you've seen, quite a few people. And because he has a personal axe to grind, there's been a lot of opportunity for Trump to say or do things that might be praiseworthy because it's contrarian to things like in the mainstream media, right? So sometimes it's just enjoyable to watch the mainstream media's lies and manipulations fall apart as they try to go after Trump, because of their different agendas that they have. But to me, I don't personally see Trump in any way, shape, or form as anti-establishment. It shows, at least based on his actions and his words and history, he is just personally very funny. He's very, sharp-witted. A lot of people think that he's stupid. I mean, that's definitely a Dunning-Kruger effect thing there. If you think that Trump is dumb, I mean, anybody who can get to that level either has to be specially selected or specially intelligent. And, it's pretty obvious that Trump didn't, get to where he was being a buffoon. He's very wise in his business dealings to be able to get to where he was and turn $1 million into $1 billion. So, he's obviously very intelligent in how he manages things. It's very controlled in how he presents himself and the things that he does. And a lot of people don't even realize that. A lot of people think that his Twitter spellings or something is a mistake. I don't think any of those are mistakes. I think they're intentional by a social media team. So, it's interesting to watch. Obviously, it's always interesting to watch people you don't like eat their words, like in the mainstream media and the statists and a lot of the leftists or Democrats, getting shut down. But there's a big difference between someone who happens to piss off people that you also don't like and someone who has ethical principles and is doing things in a manner to produce and promote ethical liberty. So, Trump's interesting to watch, but everything from what I've seen action-wise, corroborates my initial thought, which is that he just has personal issues with some people. And he's otherwise still doing the same old, signing off on big debts, signing off on more spending, signing off on, things being banned for individuals, like he did the bump stock ban from the ATF. So, you have to take everything into context.
Yeah, yeah, right. Listen, I understand you, and I know the context of everything you're saying. Just in case there's people listening that are thinking, sure, well, what would you rather instead? What kind of world do you want? Just clarify that for people.
Oh, absolutely. So, my position is, my ethics comes first. So, everything past that point of ethics is just the result of those initial ethics. And those ethics are my views as a voluntarist. So I believe in, of course, maximizing consent, minimizing the initiation of violence, helping people have more self-knowledge, understanding yourself and your childhood, which produces then more peaceful interactions with others and how you speak to them, and also peaceful child raising, learning how to raise kids with love and without threats and shame and hitting them. And tied into that worldview would be the idea that the nature of the state is just fundamentally unethical because it does things that would not be permissible for individuals to do ethically, and that are, you know, things that are violent, physically violent against other people, initiating violence. And so because of that, I'm, you know, critical of pretty much everybody who's a politician, who's in office or who works in the government, you know, by the nature of those roles. I understand that many of those people, you know, don't realize what they're doing in some regard, or, you know, have been brought up in lies and indoctrination, you know, from being government schools. So my, you know, my focus there is just changing minds. You know, the goal here is to increase peace, increase prosperity through robust respect of individuals, you know, and their stuff.
Mm. Yeah. And me and you, you know, pretty much on the same page. You know, I'm a,
right.
I mean, you know, my background, I'm a voluntarist. I don't want government solutions. I don't want taxation. I don't want the government doing anything. I mean, I like Trump insofar as I find him funny. I find it amusing, his kind of bombastic arrogance. You know, I but that's just personal preference. You know, I just find him amusing. It's nothing to do with wanting government or wanting a president or anything like that. Now,
right, exactly.
Yeah, right. So that's my position. So I see you pushing back against Stefan Molyneux quite frequently on the things he writes. So this is, I'm looking forward to asking you about this, because I don't really fully understand. I'm not sure where I stand. You know, I see him, I see the material and his arguments, and I agree, you know, I follow him, and then I see you pushing back on stuff. And so what's your main issue with stuff that Steph says?
That's a great question, so thanks for asking that. So Stefan Molyneux, as you know, you and anyone else who's been following for a little bit has seen, has started to rely on collectivism and generalizations. And what I mean by that is he's starting to think in the lens of nationalism and groups of people based on race and geography. And he's doing this in part to generate a lot of groupthink anger. And this is why this is especially concerning, is this is a stark departure from what he once was, which was a robust individualist who did not believe in the political system, who, you know, thought through all actions based on individuals and whoever they individually harm. And so in doing this, Stefan has often relied on race and IQ correlations to many faults, you know, both in the methodology of the data that he, you know, initially got, and in also false extrapolation, meaning he's looking at information, but, you know, saying something should be thought about that information that's just, you know, doesn't make sense or isn't true. And so I, you know, I've spent quite a bit of time pushing back on a lot of his generalizations, whether it's on minorities or people about, you know, race and IQ and things, because to me, this type of thinking is extraordinarily dangerous and toxic. Why it's extraordinarily dangerous and toxic is because no longer are people thinking about their own individual contributions and efforts, right? They're celebrating or taking pride in things they didn't themselves do. And they're also judging others based on things they didn't do, right? Whether you're saying, you know, it's all white or all black or anything. I mean, it would be absolutely foolish in any other context to try to generalize all people's moral culpability. You know, just like if you were to say, okay, most mass shooters in a public space in America are white males. Does that mean being a white male makes you a mass shooter? Of course not. That's, you know, and that would be a false extrapolation. It's absolutely absurd, right? You know, you can look at gun ownership, and 99.99% of people who own a gun don't shoot anybody. You know, it's virtually everybody who doesn't shoot anybody with guns at all to begin with, right? So he has that same kind of false extrapolation thinking when he applies that to race and IQ. And that's in part because he tries to associate Western development, and that is the fields of property rights and individual liberty, with just only white men, like as if that is a mandatory predicate. And then he tries to make it seem as if, okay, you must have high intelligence to enforce these types of values or to uphold these things. And then what he will try to do is try to say, okay, well, see, there's certain groups of people, and if they're minority or, you know, black, they have a lower IQ average or this or that. And the reason why this is extremely fallacious thinking is, you know, we can look at this the same way we just looked at the mass shooters, right? Yeah, sure. There are definitely white males who came up with libertarian philosophies and concepts. Absolutely. They're not the only people who did. You know, you have people like Lao Tzu who came up with libertarian philosophy, and this is, you know, way hundreds more years ago before them. But, you know, that's often ignored. So then you also have to look at the nature of other white males who do evil things, right? You can't just be like, oh, well, see, they do this, so therefore it's just white males and the high IQ, all this other stuff, right? You have to look at who's enforcing other types of policies as to the state, as to welfareism, as to war, as to colonialism and so forth, right? When you do that, it takes away a lot of this context of, oh, you know, this higher IQ or white male thing, like that's the cure, which is what he's really trying to sell. You know, he often hides that in how he uses language, but that's what he's trying to do. He's trying to appeal to a white male Christian conservative base with his rhetoric, because there are a lot of men who feel frustrated, rightly so, for the nature of the state and what's been going on socially. And there are a lot of people who feel attacked, especially Christians in America and other places, because of laws and double standards. So, you know, Stefan has rallied these people, but under false pretenses, and he's missing out. And I won't get too much into the science right now unless you have time for it, but he's missing out on how people develop both in intelligence and in philosophy. And I think he has forgotten that historically, people were dumber at large. It's this thing called the Flynn effect, where there's been an increase in G intelligence and crystallized intelligence over every 10 years. And the reason is because there's been more political stability, access to food, protein-rich food, less physical violence. And that's led to people having, you know, more intelligence over time. But the intelligence alone is still not enough, because philosophically, if you don't have those principles, it doesn't really matter. You know, you could look at the people who worked under Hitler, who were, you know, brilliant men in terms of, you know, the things that they orchestrated and did scientifically, making machines of war and things like that. Obviously, that showed intelligence, but that doesn't show ethical character if what you're, you know, using your intelligence for is to murder people at large or to use it for government violence. And I think that focusing on superficial attributes or transient attributes is very short-sighted for Stefan to do that, because he is eroding the ability to reach out to all kinds of people, because it's a matter of changing minds first and foremost, right? You know, people over time don't all have the same knowledge. You have to have an evolution, an ethical evolution of people learning how to be better, just like you have, and you learned how to, you know, be a gymnast, and you learned how to play guitar, and you learned how to, you know, publicly speak. These things take time and education and practice. And ignoring that is very dangerous, because what's that doing? It's cutting off the growth for other people and future development for philosophical change by trying to suggest that, oh, it's only a certain group that can actually, you know, do this. So, you know, I think it's a big faltering of Stefan, unfortunately. He, you know, he's definitely fallen from what, you know, he once was at his heights around 2008, 2012, in terms of his intellectual development. And, you know, when I said he was being short-sighted, I think that there is a short-sightedness that came after he got cancer. I think there's evidence to suggest that after Stefan had cancer treatment, he may have felt fear and thought that he needed to promote political solutions over his pure philosophy, because he felt like if he didn't, or he thought that if he didn't, you know, things would just go down the tube before he died. So I think possibly that Stefan saw death and stared it down the face and thought, okay, well, maybe I'll just try pandering politically and get more excitement and talk to people in the EU and the US about nationalism and, you know, and trying to bring that back up as to fight political globalism. But sadly, the reason why that doesn't last in the long term is because it's rejecting the philosophy of individualism and liberty. And as you've seen, it's not really, it doesn't really do much to have nationalism if your support of government and people around you is nothing more than a tool for fostering oppression under that guise, you know, creating a surveillance state, taxing people more than half their income, throwing them into jail for words. Literally, I think it was just the other day that I saw someone, a mother was jailed because she misgendered somebody. I mean, it was really bizarre. And, you know, people being thrown into jail for having butter knives. I mean, that's the kind of toxicity that you get when your foremost thought isn't about the nature of ethics, but it's about the nature of, you know, being one with some bigger entity, because that could always be hacked. You can't hack individualism. You can't hack that, because individualism is about thinking through individual responsibility and individual actions. There's no way to manipulate that. But you can hack collectivist psychology, because if you can turn the leadership who tells you what you should be proud of, right, just like anyone who rewrites the history books, you know, the victor goes to spoils. If you can rewrite who you're supposed to be proud of, you can raise a generation to, you know, die for you in war because you're proud of your history of your country and you want to maintain that against outsiders. So join the military and things like that. I mean, that, you know, that's the dangerous outcome of that. And so, you know, it's unfortunate that, in my opinion, you know, Stefan went that route. You know, it really taints some of his past work, but you know, his past work still stands. So,
one of the arguments he makes that I've found persuasive is that the trouble is with not acknowledging the differences in IQ is then what happens is you blame the differences in outcome on, you know, white people, for example. What do you say to that?
Well, that's another great question. So, you know, this IQ differential in terms of lifehood outcomes and probabilities correlations should be taken within context of everything else, right? You can't just isolate IQ, which, and let's be clear, in case anybody's not sure about IQ, I'm pretty well versed in this, I'd say. I've been a part of teams that have done IQ evaluations, you know, for students. So, and I, you know, independently have studied it as well. So, IQ is nothing more than a test that measures literal linear thinking in a timed period where you cannot speak out loud. And you must do everything, you know, pencil paper right in front of you. So IQ is just measuring one aspect of the human psyche in terms of logical reasoning speed. And that doesn't really encapsulate the totality of someone's abilities. Obviously, there are certain types of mental defects where your IQ response is really just the outer expression of a chromosomal disorder. If you have, you know, Down syndrome, or if you have a mental trauma, like you get hit in the head and something's wrong, right? But outside of that, if you're talking about by and large most people's intelligence that falls within that bandwidth, saying IQ is going to be your magic bullet is absolutely wrong, because the market for individual, value in terms of value creation for others is diverse, right? There is a need for people across all different types of jobs and tasks and this or that. And the idea that just being of modest intelligence or below average intelligence suddenly, undoes everything in terms of how you treat others or how you can necessarily provide value is just patently absurd. Because again, anyone who looks at the diversity of job needs would readily recognize that there is a need for people of all different types of abilities and intelligences, this or that. You don't want someone who's highly intelligent being your janitor or being the person who does the fast food, right? You want someone that's going to be able to do the job competently, but you know, you don't want lots of turnover, right? You don't want someone that's going to be bored and be like, oh, I'm out of here like 6 weeks later, right? There are definitely roles and opportunities for everyone of all kinds of intelligences and gifts, you know, at large, outside of outright disability, of course, which is a separate thing, that is important to the economy, absolutely essential. You need those, you know, people who are going to be satisfied doing certain kinds of work. So I think that is itself one of those false extrapolations that, oh, okay, see, this person's a little below average in intelligence. See, look, you know, they're an anathema. They're bad. They're just going to cause everything to go awry. It's just absolutely not true.
Let me just It sounds like you're saying everyone's equally sort of productive, but just in different ways. Everyone's economically valuable, but just in different ways. That sounds like what you're saying, but that doesn't sound right to me.
Everyone has an opportunity for being market valuable. It doesn't mean they all can do the same things. I'm not talking about egalitarianism. I'm not an egalitarianist in terms of thinking everybody has the same talents, abilities, mental capacities. What I'm saying is that this idea that, oh, IQ is the litmus test or the magic bullet test for a person's ability to respect property and to offer market value is wrong, because an IQ test does not test someone's understanding or ability to understand ethical principles. That's not what an IQ test is testing. Again, literal logical reasoning within a timed period where you can't speak. So there's several areas of bias in there already that, you know, would affect how someone would be judged as to not having that time limitation, not having the environmental limitation in terms of speaking or be able to write or do other things, right? So again, it's what you have to first start with. Wait, what is this test even testing, right? Then you have to say, okay, what am I comparing this to in terms of a judgment? So once you get past that point of realizing the IQ test is not testing someone's market value and it's not testing someone's ability to understand ethical principles outright, then you can move away from those false extrapolations, because saying they can't understand or saying, oh, they're just completely worthless is just not true.
So
absolutely not true.
But if we're saying IQ is not a reliable predictor of economic, earnings or something like that, clearly people do have a range of different capacity for like earning and furthering themselves and what do you call it? Like climbing, what's the word for it?
So market value, you're saying,
I mean clearly
productivity.
Well, clearly there's a range of some people have more sort of competence and ability to further themselves financially and climb socially. And so whether that's because of IQ or not because of IQ, there's differences in people's ability and capability to get ahead in life, isn't there? So for me,
sure,
I don't see why it makes any difference, because it still goes back to the same point for me. It's still because of internal reasons, whether it's IQ or not, it's because of inherent, or it could be because of inherent reasons that we got no control over. And so the problem still remains. If we say the differences in people's outcome in life, if we say there's no differences between people, and that we're still back to the same problem of blaming white people. Am I making sense?
No, I understand what you're saying, but I don't think it makes sense, because now that we've covered kind of the basics of thinking about IQ and how people are able to provide value or otherwise understand principles, now we need to look at the outside context of history, law, political violence, and so forth, right?
So hold on a second. I'm not sure if we've agreed or disagreed on the previous point. So whether we're attributing it to IQ or not, people have different capacity for, like, let's say, getting ahead in life. Some people are better at that, some people aren't. I mean, do we agree on that?
Yeah, of course, absolutely. There are obviously people who are tall and good at playing basketball and are going to be able to shoot hoops. There are people who have a higher logical reasoning. They have faster processing and they're able to do higher level things. There are people who are gifted artists who can paint beautifully, you know, in ways that, you know, obviously I can't. Of course, absolutely. There are diversity of abilities and talents and ways to meet market value. Absolutely.
Yeah. But some of those are going to have more economic value in terms of some people are going to get richer and some people are going to stay poor. It's like that's what's confusing me, because it sounded like you're saying, you know, everyone's got equal economic value just in different ways. That's what I'm confused about.
No, people don't have. I mean, of course, economic value is always relative, subjective to whatever someone's willing to pay. You know what I mean? Someone might be very stupid, but they might be able to charge $3,000 a night to have sex with them, right? You know what I mean? They may not be the brightest bulb, but they can command a lot of money as a hooker, right? So, I mean, there's a big difference. You know, it depends on what they're doing, right? Because someone might say, I will never do this. They might limit themselves and say, I'll never do a certain kind of work, but they could be valuable, theoretically, you know, doing something else. Some people would have made great astrophysicists, but for whatever reason, they ended up going into, you know, managing, you know, construction, right? You know what I mean? So it's like they're, because of the opportunity cost of human learning, they're going to just be through choices or circumstances, natural limitations to what people could do optimally, right? And in other words, someone may have the capacity to command a higher income, but will they ever achieve it? You know, it depends, right? There's a lot of other variables that go into that in the first place. But of course, some people are going to have biologically traits that make their propensity for certain types of economic activity more valuable. Absolutely. Absolutely. But, you know, chalking it up to that, you know, all just pure biology and that's all you have, that would also be itself a problem or a fallacy, because skills can, of course, be attained over time and practice, and one can increase their market value with, you know, with a training and practice, just like, as I'm sure you have, you know, grown your skills in various disciplines and have become more valuable to others than you were, you know, 6 years ago, last time we, you know, did a little interview. So
Yeah, but the thing is, I don't think anybody, whether it's Steph or anybody else, actually argues that it's all just because of biology. They're arguing that it's a factor, right, amongst other factors, as you're pointing out.
Well, he is arguing for, sometimes, you know, through tongue-in-cheek, sometimes through some sophistic framing of things. But he is always arguing for policy based on that. So in other words, he is, you know, was singing the national anthem to Trump, being all supportive of him. He was talking about building a wall, or like promoting building a wall. Obviously, that involves the state. So he has definitely been using this as a backdrop to promoting what I consider collectivist, statist, nationalist policies and ideas. And to me, that is what is a very big problem, is when you're trying to use these things. Again, it's a false extrapolation about, you know, if that other thing he's saying is true, then something else. And it's also damaging to the growth of liberty, because it is marring the message by saying that, oh, only certain people are going to be able to understand this. And oh, by the way, it just is based on your skin color. So, you know, it's kind of a very sophistic, you could say, game that he's playing, or his social media manager is playing, because they're the ones posting this stuff, you know, with his rhetoric. So again, you know, it's not that simple. This isn't just saying, oh, okay, some scientists did some studies and, you know, measured people's IQ across the world and various things, and okay, there's that. You know what I mean? He's trying to make inferences about government policy based on that.
I'm glad you mentioned the wall, because that was the other thing, you know, the other main argument besides the IQ thing that I was going to ask you about, because it makes sense to me. Steph basically says you can have borders or you can have welfare, but you can't have both, kind of thing. Like, you know, if you've got a welfare state that's redistributing people's wealth and socialism within the borders of the United States, then you can't then, you know, you can't then just let the rest of the world in, because you're basically abusing the taxpayers. You know, it's like one or the other. So I mean, that makes sense to me. So what's your position on that?
Sure. Well, to even make that statement requires a couple of assumptions that are just patently false. The first assumption here is that the government can ethically build a wall. If the wall is being built by taxation and there's eminent domain being used to take people's lands, that's not possible, right? So right off the bat, government doing anything with stolen money is unethical. So that's already out. Now,
yeah, I accept that. Yeah, any government, anything the government does was paid for with stolen money. So it's all
right.
It's all unethical, yeah.
Right. And then the other part that's, to me, the most fascinating intellectually is this idea that the government can also effectively do this without turning it into something to further abuse Americans, or anybody else for that matter. And I think the history is pretty clear at this point that any power given to the government never is limited thereafter. It always keeps growing. It's always used for the political conveniences of those in power. And there is no meaningful way to manage that. I mean, it takes illusions of grandeur to think that, anybody, who's not a multi-billionaire or, very seasoned long-term power establishment person has any meaningful control over what happens, with the money and the wall and, people traveling. It's just, it's kind of silly. It's like, it's like a mouse, wishing, that they could rule cats. It's just not happening. This idea that, there's going to be limited government as to that policy. And we can already see a violation of people's rights, even without the wall, with what has been done under the border policy. And according to the U.S. border policy, within 100 miles of all water around the United States, which actually covers about 66%+ of all the United States population, because a lot of people live relatively close to the water, within 100 miles for convenience. So within that border, there is a literal constitution-free zone because the Border Patrol has been given special authority to stop people randomly. They have border checkpoints within 100 miles, and they have lower standards for taking people's stuff and searching them. So normally you'd have to have a warrant to search, your laptop. A Border Patrol agent can, with just reasonable suspicion, take your computer equipment from you, take all the information off of it, and wait months to give it back to you. And that's 100 miles inside the United States because of the fear of border issues and worries about, there's going to be illegal immigrants. And that actually has been used and has been shown to have been used on American citizens, people who are just driving along, going within the states because that border goes within 100 miles. People have been harassed. People have been arrested, locked up over border policy. I've watched videos where there are people who are working on a house, right? And ICE agents just bust on in through the front door without even a warrant to come and arrest people who are working to build a house, right? These are just Mexicans who want to work, make money, send home money to their family, loved ones, just like anybody else who is just trying to make a life. And government agents are violating a citizen's home to go into this house that's being worked on. They're breaking and entering and damaging their property, and then taking people out who are trying to do a job that some citizen hired them for. So, we can't just think about these concepts without the ramifications of what happens with the nature of the government, because these are concrete things. This isn't just theoretical. We know what the government does when it has power and money, right? This is not like a mystery. The people in the power use it to steal more, to fund the war machine, to line their pockets, through defense contractors. They do it to disarm their political opponents, whether it's, politically or through literal gun bans and other things to try to go after people. And, it's very scary what is happening in America, and as I'm sure you've seen in the UK, how that power that the government has continues to grow to be used to further oppress. And that's what I see with the wall or anything like that, is it'd be, again, short-sighted to think that this is going to be used for anything other than oppressing American citizens.
Well, of course I agree with all that, and Steph would agree with all that, and I'm not I don't know, let me see here. I'm sure that's the same position that Steph has, but I feel like he's speaking to statists when he says, if you want socialism, then you can't have open borders. That still makes sense to me. I'm struggling to see how that's unreasonable, because it's.
Well, that's not his only. That's not the only thing he's ever said on these things. I've been following Stefan. I still keep up with his stuff because I'm just always curious about the culture and what's happening and what's being done. And I've watched countless videos, including one where he was the most forthcoming. Was he spoke with Tom Woods a couple months ago, and you can watch that whole interview about I think it was a 22-minute mark. Don't hold me to that exactly, but it's within that video. It's somewhere within the first third. He actually, dives in a little bit more about his, ideas as to government and borders and things like that. So, you know, when you listen to that, his position is very clear. So, you know, we can't summarize Stefan into one sentence. Stefan literally speaks hours, sometimes a day. And if you listen and read his, you know, the Facebook update, I mean, obviously, I think it's a social media manager by and large for those. But again, they're approved. So if you read through the messages, if you see the videos, you'll see that this pattern here, and also the comments also give an indication of the kind of people who are drawn to this. The purpose is to unite a Christian conservative nationalistic sense, right, is a reactionary thing, so that he can get more of his message out there and get and more support. And as you see now, obviously, in terms of subscribers and money and all that good stuff, you know, he's had that increase in support. And one of the things Stefan said, actually, in reference to his change, which I found very disappointing, was he said, well, the libertarians, they, you know, put up a fight with me about peaceful parenting. And I just my jaw just dropped, because him saying that just completely, you know, rejects every shred of evidence that has showed that his work on peaceful parenting impacted tons of other people who went on to promote peaceful parenting and to talk about nonviolent communication, help other people. And I think, you know, that kind of, you know, that statement that he made was just, to me, very sad, because I think for whatever reason, he missed the meaningful impact he had, and he sold out to, you know, the collectivist rhetoric. I think maybe because of that fear, and maybe because we didn't recognize the impact he had made.
Well, it was definitely noticeable as soon as he started covering kind of current events and hot topics and stuff, and commenting on the news cycle. Yeah, you know, the YouTube views shot through the roof, you know. So yeah, it's clear to see. And I've heard him comment that, you know, he feels torn, you know, whether to keep doing that or whether to, you know, focus on other stuff. So yeah, it definitely has that effect, doesn't it? Sort of, I don't know what the word is. I don't want to say like appealing or pandering, but mm-hmm. but focusing on the topics that are going to have the widest appeal. Yeah, I mean, I don't know what to say about that. I don't know if it's a smart thing or not, but yeah, the effects are noticeable.
Right. I mean, and there's nothing wrong with covering news events. It's not, I don't have any problem with that. It's just what he's doing now in terms of what he's saying about that and how people should think or feel about these various situations, as to government policy, immigration, borders. Because, I mean, and just to make this extra clear for other people, I am 100% against all forms of government subsidizing, funding, allocating for immigration. You know what I mean? Like, I think that some of the things that have been done are absolutely atrocious. You know, like Germans, somewhere forcibly moved out of their homes to make room for migrants. That was, to me, absolutely disgusting, a violation of their individual property rights. But we have to keep remembering here that these issues that relate to immigration, by and large, right, by and large, are due to the U.S. government's policies and violence in the first place. If we ignore that history, you miss out on fixing the problem, because the history with Middle East intervention, funding the Mujahideen, you know, the freedom fighters fighting the Soviets, you know, funding the revolution, the Ayatollah in Iran, funding different, you know, groups in South America, you know, Iran-Contra, all that stuff. If you miss the history of the government's drug running and arms running and interventions and coups, and then miss also that those governments disarmed the people, disarmed the Germans, disarmed the British, you know, people in America, they're trying to disarm us here too. You know, you miss the fact that these problems in the first place were created by the people that proverbially you or Stefan is trying to give more power or suggest they deserve more power. And that is what I consider to be ethically or morally insane, because no reasonable person who sits through the history of what has taken place could realistically say, oh, you know, giving the government more power, you know, to build a wall or manage that in some way is going to fix the root problem, because the root problem was the government having power and funding and the ability to go to war and do these coups and to disarm people in the first place. You know what I mean? These people are being victimized by the government, and the government's creating this culture clash war intentionally. You know what I mean? I see this all as planning. I don't, you know, the whole thing with the migrants, all this other stuff and whatever, this is not wanton. This is not just out of nowhere. This is planned. This is meant to create a culture war so that people fight each other instead of looking at the nature of who is running these banking deals with governments around the world, putting people into debt, you know, for their whole lives, and murdering people and locking them up in cages or victimless crimes. All of this is meant to keep people fighting each other of all different types of backgrounds and nationalities, when in reality, the only group of people that really is torturing, murdering, and thieving from people at large at unprecedented levels are people in the big Western governments by and large. And to ignore that history and to ignore the fact that the people who created the welfare states in the first place were the native population, politicians, legislators, it just misses the mark so far, you know, that it's concerning because, you know, if you don't, as you know, as the idiom mantra goes, you know, if you don't learn your history, you're going to repeat it. And so sadly, that's what I've seen here is I've seen a lot of people who have forgotten how things got to be where they are today in geopolitical history, war, coups, thefts, you know, banking deals. And, you know, it makes sense because public school is indoctrinating young kids to love the state and to crave it.
But given there's a welfare state, how do we know? I think you're saying, like, you know, because of U.S. foreign interventions and invasion, that's creating, like, you know, refugees and stuff like that. How do we how do we know what portion of those influx of people are refugees or asylum seekers versus people coming for, you know, welfare and free stuff? How do we know?
Oh, well, I mean, it would. I don't really think that that's a question that matters to the ethics. If you're just curious about data, you would just look at, you know, various governments have, you know, census information for people who actually get official asylum. I think the U.S. has like 60,000 or something like that a year. But if you're talking about just people coming over, you know, from like Mexico or something like that, right? Oh, yeah, definitely there are people who are coming for welfare and benefits. Absolutely. Absolutely. I'm not saying that there aren't. Now, of course, it should be very clear that if you're not a citizen, you don't get benefits from the federal government. So what are we really talking about, right? We're talking about people going to states where the states, that is the state governments, are giving extra special handouts, giving special leeway. You know, public schools and other good stuff, right? I shouldn't say good stuff, bad stuff. Good, they think it's good stuff, but obviously, you know, toxic. So it has to be very clearly understood that these incentives are being put out there by those state governments. So, you know, I mean, you can't fix any of these problems no matter what, unless you fix that root problem. And that root problem is not going to get fixed with even without the immigration. And we have to remember specifically why. The reason why it can't get fixed, regardless of immigration, is fundamentally because those things were not put in due to immigration in the first place. Right? These things that exist now, the welfare state structures, they weren't put in when, you know, there was 11 million, you know, people from Mexico here. They were put in, you know, 50 years ago, 80 years ago. If we're talking, going back to, you know, FDR's New Deal and Social Security, you know, and talking about Medicare, Medicaid, we're talking about mandatory public schooling. You know what I mean? These are not things that were created because a bunch of people from out of, you know, the country voted for them. They're put in by the native population. So that's the first problem. The first problem is that it doesn't matter whether you have people from outside the country or not. If you can't change the people's minds no matter what, well, then forget about it. It's over. It's gone. You know what I mean? The country's over. It doesn't even matter anymore because if you can't change minds no matter what, it doesn't matter. So the whole idea of giving government more power is just completely counterproductive, obvious for obvious reasons when it comes to, you know, the history of government. But worse, if we're not changing minds, even of people who, you know, are coming in from out of the country, then it's all for nothing because you're not going to change anything.
I mean, I agree with everything you're saying. I feel like I just want to circle back round and just want to I want to try and pin you on one point. Like given I agree, you know, we'd rather have no government, we'd rather have a free market. I agree. But I think what's being said is if there is a government and socialism, then the influx of people has to be controlled. I mean, that's what I'm asking. Do you agree or disagree with that? Like, starting from that, if, like, let's take it as a given, there is redistribution of wealth.
No, I think that's a false dichotomy, or, you know, a black or white fallacy, because that's not reality. The real reality is we as individuals have zero power over what the government does. We have zero power over what's going to happen with wars by and large, or with redistributions. We have, you know, we're virtually powerless, at least in America, on the federal level, federal government specifically, because that's a unique structure. So I just don't even like I don't even see that as a realistic construct. What I do see with that language, though, is missing the mark about the question of how did you get the welfare state in the first place? That is the core element that you have to recognize, because I understand you're trying to say, okay, well, if there's going to be this welfare state, then, well, we have to somehow limit immigration, because otherwise people are just going to, you know, use that and abuse that. But that doesn't actually change the use or abuse. The use or abuse is happening with or without the immigrants. The second that welfare systems open up, it's being used and abused by the native population. So it's kind of silly.
Yeah, but it's going to be used more by more people drawing upon it. No?
Well, of course it will be used more if more people are let in to use it, which brings back the question of, wait a second, what are we thinking? Are we thinking we need to make two ethical wrongs here by having welfare and then giving government more power to build a wall? Or is the principled ethical stance that you want everybody around the world to understand what individual liberty is and what free market economics is, and that the welfare state is the core problem? Giving government more power, again, is not going to solve that. It's going to, as has been shown time and again, only increase the abuse of the native population. It's not, you know what I mean? Like, it's one of those self-defeating statements, right?
So you think it'd be net worse, basically?
What's that?
You think it would be net worse by giving government more power to build a big wall and have more power over immigration? That would be like a net detriment to the population versus like letting anyone in and letting them draw on the welfare. You think it would be like, you think one of those scenarios would be a greater burden to the citizens?
I think it would be as applied and how it ends up being used in the, again, reality, not speculative. Oh, here's my ideal situation, how I think government's going to work, right? Because if you believed you can control government ethically and effectively, then why would you be a voluntarist, right? If you think, oh, I have power to control what government does, I can make the government do things, you know, morally and ethically right. And not only that, I can do it effectively. I can manage exactly what they're going to do. You're getting to like illusions of grandeur level, like this idea of an ant thinking they can control an airplane. Like it's not happening. Like this idea of, oh, yes, the government's just going to do exactly what we think, and it's not going to further any harms, and it's not going to use it to, you know, continue to steal from people and continue to harass, native population or otherwise, is absolutely preposterous and demonstrably false, because we've seen exactly what the U.S. government deep state does when it comes to proxy wars. And we've seen exactly what the U.S. government does when it comes to arresting people at large for victimless crimes. We've seen exactly what the government does with eminent domain, which is, of course, is required to build the wall. And we've seen exactly what the government does whenever they get more powers, which is to grow it and to use it against American citizens, just like the 100-mile border policy. So, I mean, again, I'm working within the reality of what actually is demonstrably true about the nature of government. You know, I'm not speculating, like wondering, maybe this happened. Maybe. No, it's like we know it's been done many time and again, and many empires have risen and fallen on the same cycle. And no, it wasn't because they lacked nationalism. It's always fundamentally, Roman or otherwise, because the government, the people in government got full of their power and started to use it to plunder people, you know, strip people of monetary stability and to hand out favors for political convenience. You know, that's what this boils down to. Politics is about the politicians staying in power. So they're always incentivized to do whatever they need to do, twist and turn, to get whoever they want to vote for them. And that's the nature of, you know, political incentives. It's extremely perverse and just evil, you know, at its foundation.
Yeah, right. I see. Yeah. So you're sticking to the principles, and essentially it's irrelevant what government like chooses to do, because it's all going to be bad, like, anyway, you know, whether they do this with him, whether they increase the border controller, if they don't, it kind of doesn't matter, you know, because it's just wrong from the first place. I think that's what you're saying.
Well, right. I mean, and just think about it. Who has voted themselves to freedom, right? Who in the world in history has voted themselves to freedom? You're not going to find it, because virtually every single advancement in polity toward freedom came at the bayonet, or, you know, came at violence, because eventually people said enough is enough. We're tired of being robbed, stolen, raped, and we're going to stand up, you know, and sometimes, sadly, those people lose. You know what I mean? As we've seen in history, sadly, the people who try to go for liberty sometimes lose. And that's very sad, you know, that that happens. But ultimately, in terms of meaningful progression toward, you know, actually enumerating rights and trying to establish individual liberty, that has always come from an, you know, a conflict climax, you know, with some group of people having to fight literally for their freedom. And sadly, you know, from what I've seen, I don't see meaningful change for liberty in any of these developed nations coming from people who are just going to try to vote their way out. I mean, even the, you know, the, I mean, there's still technically a lot of them are socialists, but even the French rioters who got mad about the tax, right? What did they do? They started throwing, you know, dung on the, you know, the their parliament. They started, you know, setting things on fire. They started, you know, burning police and government buildings, right? That was real change there in terms of making a statement, right? You know, and it's not my goal. I don't want, you know, violence or any type of political conflict. I wish for things to be free without any kind of violence. But I do see that there will eventually come to a head where people are going to either have to flee for freedom. So in other words, running, you know, from oppression, like many have in history. You know, America was founded on people who fled the persecution of England and came to America themselves, or you're going to have to fight. And we're running out of places in the world to flee to at this point. So, you know, that's what it is.
So how do you see this playing out then? I mean, do you see violence, civil war? What's your outlook?
Well, I mean, my outlook is hopeful for people like us who are, you know, keeping our ears to the ground with what's going on. People like us who are, you know, abreast of things happening geopolitically, who are abreast of, you know, technological advancement changes. We can see the dangers coming, and maybe people like us might be able to flee to some area where maybe we'll survive.
And you think that would be necessary? You think it could come to that?
Well, here's the stepping stones that we're already watching take place, right? Look at China. China has implemented one of the most insane social credit systems ever devised. You know, I mean, the Soviets would cry to get this kind of technology. But the Chinese government has been able to effectively implement a social credit monitoring system where all people are monitored at all times and, you know, tracked to every electronic device they have. And if the government wants to make you a non-person, they can shut off your travel. They can shut off your bank account. They can use social pressure by saying, oh, hey, someone close to you, you know, has a bad credit rating. And they can, you know, even without having to lift a finger to hurt anybody, they can, through social manipulation, extinguish any divergent thought from the mainline Communist Party. Of course, there definitely has been some physical violence too with re-education camps for millions of people. But that's what we're seeing. We're seeing this new height of technological oppression that, you know, people often joke about, you know, 1984, George Orwell, stuff like that. This is the reality of that realized. And I think you've already seen it to some extent, because obviously the UK was some of the first to have that whole citywide cameras in London, to have the Tempora program where they had a full take of all information. I mean, they were taking everything. Everybody's cell phone data, internet search data, they had a full take system for that before even the NSA, from my understanding.
What, in England?
So, yes.
Oh, I didn't realize that myself.
Yes. So, yeah, no, the UK under the Tempora program has had full take of all your information, right? So obviously people joke
that.
About that. Yeah, yeah. And actually, Edward Snowden talked about this quite a bit. It came out before him, but he was the one that, you know, brought it to the mainstream,
you know what?
Light.
There was something that happened. I won't say the exact details of what happened, but mm-hmm. I had an interaction with some police, and they asked me a question, about stuff that I had no idea how they knew, like how they were asking me. I had no idea where it had come from. They said, oh, you've done this, that, and the other, haven't you? And I was like, I couldn't figure it out. I was like, did my dad say something to them? Or like, what happened? Somebody must have told. And it really puzzled me. But maybe they did have access to information that, you know, that I wasn't aware of.
It's possible. You obviously, I don't know for sure, but I can tell you this, that when it comes to the access or ease of access, UK is one of the worst in terms of the government's direct access. Now, of course, you know, people will joke and say, hey, you know, whatever, they're not going to look at your, you know, dick pics to like whatever girl or something like that. But realistically, they have this full take data, because anytime someone does pose a threat or does ruffle some politicians or power persons' feathers, that's when they data dive and go and find out what they can about this person to, you know, target them. I mean, it's terrifying how deep that's gone, how long that's gone on for in the UK. And the US has always been a little bit behind the UK in that, but the US has always, you know, caught up within about a 10-year span. You know, the things that were happening in the 2000s with, you know, the data capturing the cameras, you know, that kind of crept up in the US about 2010 on a, you know, larger scale level. So these are things that are technologically in place, and they are very close to, with the right apparatus, being no different than the Chinese social credit system, where the government is literally manipulating everybody's information and monitoring everybody's information, so that anyone who might pose a threat or a problem can be soft eliminated. Again, it no longer requires, you know, doing a hit, you know, taking somebody out or shooting them in the street. You can literally use different elements of, you know, economic access or social access limitations to make someone a non-person. And that, to me, is a very dangerous reality for both you and I, if we don't work really hard to change minds and to help promote technologies to circumvent this, because it's very real. It's, you know, this is not fantasy. It's really being done right now. You can go, anybody can go Google China social credit system. It is fully implemented. And I've talked to people who are in China right now who watch the change happen, and they're like, this is absolutely crazy.
It was a truly free market, that like regulating people's behavior in those kind of soft ways would be cool, because you could choose to like go and use a different service provider or something, and there'd be like a competition element to it, you know, to where, you know, the it would be done in a way that was acceptable to people. But because it's all being done by one government and there's no other choice, then it's what do you call it, dictatorship or whatever.
Well, yeah, I mean, and more so just that with the government, they treat it criminally. Like, I read a news story just the other day that some Briton was walking along, and they were doing it's not technically AI, but a scanning facial recognition software test. You know, they were machine learning for it. And because this guy, like, covered his face as he walked past it, they fined him. They fined him because he covered his face as he walked past their machine learning module, you know, just capturing people's faces walking around London. That is what's coming, and it's very concerning, to say the least.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. I always get a little bit excited when I think about, I mean, do you think, what do you call it, blockchain technology and encrypted communication, like, what's it called when you have ad hoc networks that are not, like, non-centralized? Do you think there's possibility in that stuff, or is the government just going to be able to over-govern any of that, any of those kind of stuff?
Well, I'd say, all right, so when it comes to those kind of technologies, obviously they're going to have their greatest impact in regions where governments are not the strongest to begin with, right? You know, you need, like, people who use this technology in what are considered historical second or third world countries actually are going to be the most prepared and helped because the government can't really keep up with it. Obviously now, you know, in the US, unfortunately, because of the proliferation of blockchain technology and decentralized applications, the government started to come after it, right? They started to try to get people on tax issues. They passed a law that, it, you know, obliterated a lot of the trading in America, because they said that if you make a trade, that's a taxable event. So in other words, before you could be like, hey, I'm going to trade, Bitcoin for Litecoin for Steam for whatever. There's no taxable event just because you traded. Then the IRS, came out and said, oh, okay, we're going to tax you every time you make a trade. And that killed trading because now people are not just going to make small trades. They're only going to trade on the biggest swings. They're coming. They are the people who are in government are scared because they realize some of this technology, if used right, can offer some pretty meaningful privacy to people who use it that way, and it can also offer some people some financial freedom to escape very difficult situations. So I do see that there is a resistance to the NSA's spying and the federal government's monopoly on money, but this is an active battle. This isn't something that is fixed, and the government's going to use every single mechanism, as well as the big banks are going to use every single mechanism they can to curtail competition to their monopoly powers. It's a scary reality, but it's encouraging to see people fight. Very encouraging.
In terms of your personal choices for your life, I don't know if you're going to start a family. Perhaps you are, but where are you going to choose to live, and what's your plans, long-term plans?
Well, without telling the NSA too much, have plans for family, have plans to continue doing what I'm doing here over in the States. Obviously, with how things have gone, I do have my eyes set on what's next and what may need to be a plan to exit, because there are enough mechanisms that have coalesced in America to really go after people in a dangerous way. There's enough laws, there's enough technological surveillance, there is enough government power that if push came to shove and certain people in government decided to pick on people like us, it could get nasty very fast. And, in the past, you usually only have to see this kind of stuff with certain types of more fringe elements, potentially, like you think of, Bundy Ranch, or you think, ATF incidents and, different types of smaller, governments going after like certain, they call it, radicals, you call it. But, should we become successful, which I think we have actually at this point because of the evidence from the banning and the blocking of all the alternative news agencies online, through Facebook and other channels, I think that those government guns could very well come toward, people like us. And I know you've experienced that firsthand, and it wasn't even politically related. You know what it's like, for the government to pick on you. So it's very scary.
Yeah. Who do you follow? I mean, who do you learn from? Who do you look up to?
I actually look up a lot to Ben Lowrey. I watch his videos and I see how strong he is. I watch him always growing his skills, and I'm like, okay, this guy is waking up inspired every day. I got to keep working on my projects too, So I do. I believe it or not, I do actually look at you and talk about you, and take some cues from you from how you develop your business stuff, because it's always inspiring to see people who are passionate like you are and crave growing, their business, their business skills and their professional development. And I really have enjoyed your attitude toward leaving out negative people who just don't want to have that mindset of growth, because I agree with you. That's so important. People who are not willing to be open about business and growth and growing their skills and growing their mind. I mean, those people are going to just, drag you down. Because they're not on the same path as you in terms of thinking about how to do better for themselves, how to live healthier, how to have more peace, how to have more financial stability. I mean, you don't want people in your life who think those topics should be taboo or, think that you're less of a person. I mean, that's just absolute insanity. It's an impoverished mindset. Mm. And so with there, I completely agree with you that, it's important to encourage people to, not accept that kind of small-minded mentality. It's important to keep a mentality of thinking about how you can grow every day.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I appreciate the compliment. And there's some of these things is stuff that I've only realized recently, you know, just going through changes in my own life, realizing the importance of being in environments and surrounded by people who are supportive of your own goals and stuff is massive, you know, because if and just the topic of, you know, if you don't feel like you can express yourself freely, that's no way to live, you know, it's maddening.
Right. Oh, I know.
Don't go to yoga, kids. So yeah, so that, you know, there's definitely positivity on that. Just recently I joined a coaching group. I don't know if you've been following stuff I've posted, but there's six of us and who are being led and mentored by a coach as well, and we're going to pool our resources and invest in property, but not just, wow, like, yeah, not just the property side of it, but it's very holistic in terms of we're all dealing with we're all working through like every area of life as well. It's like, you know, we're dealing with it all in one go, not just finances. So that's been really positive. Yeah. And I've been much happier just, you know, cause for me, like, business is like a creative process, really. I mean, I find it a lot of fun, you know, it excites me. It fills me with energy and enthusiasm. And so, yeah, I'm much more myself when I'm having those kind of conversations, you know?
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, if you're not around people who are also looking to grow with you, then yeah, it ends up being very miserable and can't express yourself and you know, can't share your passions and aspirations. So yeah, I appreciate that you're continuing with that because it's exciting and I'm looking forward to see you succeed.
Is there any events coming up?
For me, nothing. Well, I don't know what coming up would be, but the next thing I'm about to launch will be the next comic campaign in terms of something interesting. So I'll be doing that in roughly a month and a half. So there's a lot of things I had to prepare for that, and I'm still, you know, about to ship out goods and other things from the last one. So that'll be fun. But yeah, there'll be some fun events coming up this year. I'm going to go to Mises Institute this summer too. So that'll be a lot of fun.
All right. What for?
They're educational seminars, so it's like a networking plus, you know, discussion about economics and ethics, a week-long thing with a lot of the top scholars there at that institute. So, you know, for me, it'll just be a little fun time, but also a time to share ideas, talk, and, you know, network with some people who are like-minded.
Yeah, it's a nice feeling. I have the sense that I've got friends such as yourself sort of over in America, and even though it's a virtual reality friendship, you know, I've not been over there and been to any of these events or anything, but I kind of feel like I've got some kind of you know, network of peers over there. You know, one day I might get over there and, you know, meet people.
Yeah, oh, of course. I would love to have you on over if you ever visit in Florida. So right. I don't know that I'll be visiting the UK anytime soon. I haven't visited there in a number of years, but I don't know. Now it's terrifying. So
yeah, stay away from Europe.
Yeah, it's not that great right now. So.
Yeah, yeah. Well, Jaime, thanks ever so much for your time. That was a great conversation. I appreciate it.
Oh, my pleasure.
All the best with the comic, and we'll catch up again soon.
Yeah, hopefully we don't have to wait another 6 years, maybe just a year or two.
Yeah, agree. All right, I'll speak to you soon. Thanks, Jaime.
All right, take care.
Bye-bye.